Hello grade 11s, welcome to Edu-ca-te. Let us do a little bit of practice on gaseous exchange. So here this question I've just taken from grade 11 November 2023 Eastern Cape. So now let us just try to answer question 3. It says that the diagram below represents an alveolus. So first up, if you do not understand how gaseous exchange occurs at alveolus, I strongly recommend that you watch our video on gaseous exchange at the alveolus. I'll make sure to put the link in the description and they'll just pop up here on top so that you can easily access it first before you answer these questions. So in these questions, you can see that this is a diagram of an alveolus, and here let us first start at the arrows. This arrow indicates that there is incoming air that is coming in, and then this arrow here indicates that there is air coming out, yes, of the alveolus. So the air that is coming in, it is coming in because it was inhaled, right? And it is rich in oxygen. So you can see that here there are arrows showing that the air that is rich in oxygen, that oxygen is diffusing into the what? Into the surrounding blood vessels. Whereas this other side, you can note that carbon dioxide is what? Is leaving. Carbon dioxide is leaving the blood and it is to be exhaled. So that's real analysis that is needed. So now 3.1.1 says asks us to identify the gas which is at high concentration in blood vessel B. So let us look at blood vessel B. You can see that blood vessel B is bringing in blood from some place. Remember in this case that this blood is rich in carbon dioxide. Why do I say that? You can see that here at this point, if I can use a red color, here these arrows here, they are indicating that a gas is diffusing out from the blood vessel into the alveolus, and the only gas that leaves the blood vessels and goes into the alveolus is known as carbon dioxide. So we can say that this blood that is here in this region, that is in part B, it is rich in carbon dioxide. So the answer there for the first question is carbon dioxide. And 3.1.2 says we must state the action word. We must state two ways in which this gas in B is transported in the blood. So we have identified the gas inside B to be carbon dioxide. So now they would like to know how is it transported in the blood. So carbon dioxide, remember that it is transported in form of bicarbonate ions. So the first way is bicarbonate ions. So bicarbonate ions is the form in which carbon dioxide is transported in the blood, and then it can also be blood plasma. Can also be blood plasma. So carbon dioxide can also be transported in the blood as blood plasma. So the other third way is uncommon, but carbon dioxide can also combine with hemoglobin and forms something known as carbinar hemoglobin. Yeah, if I still remember well, it's something like this, carbinar hemoglobin. So these are the three ways in which carbon dioxide is transported in the blood. Remember, if they had asked for oxygen, you would have said that it is transported as oxyhemoglobin, but then if it is carbon dioxide, it is always transported in form of bicarbonate ions and as well as blood plasma and carbinar hemoglobin as well. So the other thing, let's now go to 3.1.3. So 3.1.3 asks which large blood vessel receives blood from A. So you can see that here is our A. You can see that here at A, this blood is rich in oxygen. Let me just use a blue color to indicate that. Remember that here, the air that was coming in here is rich in oxygen because it was inhaled. So it means at this point, there is a lot of oxygen that is moving from the alveolus to the surrounding blood vessel. So this blood is oxygenated. So they would like to know which blood vessel receives oxygenated blood from A. So which blood vessel is this blood that is reaching oxygen going to? We say it is known as the pulmonary vein. So remember that pulmonary vein is a vein, it's a large blood vessel, or it's a vein that is found in the lungs. I'm sure you know it from grade 10. Pulmonary vein always carries oxygenated blood. So this blood that is reaching oxygen at point A will go to the pulmonary vein. So that is the large blood vessel that receives blood from A. That is just 1 mark. And then now 3.1.4, they want us to give a reason, an observable reason for our answer. So they say give an observable reason. So the word observable just means that the reason must be seen from the diagram. It is not something you know, but something you saw in the diagram. So you cannot give the reason that the blood is oxygenated, therefore it must go to the pulmonary vein. Not really, because you cannot see here that the blood is oxygenated. They did not put any labels that allows you to say that. When they say give an observable reason, they want something that you can see, something that everyone can see. So now they want us to give a reason. Why do we say that this blood goes to the pulmonary vein? It is because we can see the direction of the arrow. So the direction of this arrow, if we can notice here, this direction of the arrow, this arrow here, it shows that the blood is moving out. So most of the time, the blood that is moving out in this way, it is reaching oxygen, right? And its direction is already telling us that it is moving out. So it means that it has to be going to the pulmonary vein. Remember that in my video on introducing gaseous exchange at the alveolus, when the blood is moving in, it has got a lot of carbon dioxide. It is moving towards the alveolus, and when it is moving away from the alveolus, it means that it is now rich in oxygen. It has received oxygen at the alveolus through the gaseous exchange thingy. So now the thing is here, the direction of the arrow, gonna say the direction of the arrow is away from the alveolus. Away from alveolus. So when the direction of the blood flow, or of this arrow representing the flow of blood, if it's going away from the alveolus, it means that it is going towards a pulmonary vein. It has got oxygenated blood. But then if it is going towards the alveolus, it means that it has got blood with a lot of carbon dioxide, and that carbon dioxide needs to be exhaled. Do you want to get more benefits from this channel? From only 20 rands per month, you too could become a member and get exclusive benefits and even private tutoring. Click join on our channel page to find out. So now let's go to 3.1.5. So 3.1.5 says explain two ways in which the blood cell labeled D is structurally suited for its function. So if I can just clear things up here, D, they are referring to this blood cell here. So the blood cell D, remember that we've got two types of blood cells, is the red blood cells and the white blood cells. So the ones that are associated with the exchange of gases, they are known as the red blood cells, or they are known as the erythrocytes. So here, when they are mentioning label D, they are talking about the erythrocytes. So now they want to know what makes erythrocytes to be suited for their function. So first of all, what is the function of erythrocytes or red blood cells? The function of red blood cells is to carry oxygen. You can see that the moment that oxygen enters into the blood here at this region, the blood vessels, or these red blood cells, these erythrocytes, have to carry the oxygen towards the pulmonary vein there and eventually go to the heart. So now, what makes it suitable for it to do that function? First of all, remember that the erythrocytes, they contain or they have hemoglobin. So they contain hemoglobin. So now you don't just end here and say that you're done answering. Remember they said you should explain. So you need to state the structural adaptation and then give a support it. Why is it a structural adaptation? So in this case, what does the hemoglobin do to the red blood cells? This hemoglobin carries oxygen to transport oxygen. So it can take carry or transport. That's all acceptable. So here, it is a structural suitability as well. It contains hemoglobin, 1 mark, and then that hemoglobin will do what? Will transport oxygen. So the red blood cells are therefore suited for their function. Or we can say the erythrocytes are suited for their function. Then now the other reason is that you can see that the shape of these red blood cells is sort of like a disc shape. So they are disc shaped. So part D is disc shaped. So when you say something is disc shaped, it just means it looks like a disc. I'm sure we all know a disc is something like this. So the fact that they are disc shaped, how does that help with the function of the erythrocytes? So this disc shape allows, or we can just say it allows more surface area for the transportation of oxygen. So let's just say provides a larger surface area, you're gonna write it in full, a larger surface area for transportation of oxygen. Yeah, and that's about it. Transportation of oxygen. So here we're trying to say that because the shape is disc-shaped like this, it means that it has got enough surface area. It is disc-shaped, that's 1 mark. And then that will give enough surface area or a larger surface area for the transportation of oxygen. Then the last question is quite simple. So 3.1.6 says we should explain. Whenever they say explain, you need to like give a brief explanation. Don't just state something. So here they say explain why it is not advisable to sleep in an unventilated room where a heater is switched on. So here we've got a lot of things to look at. So here, sleeping in an unventilated room where a heater is switched on. So when I talk about ventilation, most of the times we're talking about a place, let's just say a window is a ventilator, for example. A window is a ventilator because it allows fresh air to enter in your room, right? So if we are saying that a place is unventilated, it's more of a place that is isolated. It does not have anything that will allow fresh air to move into that, to flow into that room. So that unventilated room, there is even a heater, and that heater is on. So now in an unventilated room, we need to know that a heater, when you turn on a heater, it actually dries the air. It will make the air to be drier. How do I mean? The air contains moisture, right? The air contains water vapor or moisture. So the heater, when you turn on the heater, it will strip off that moisture. It will dry the air. So the heater will, let's just say the heater reduces the moisture of the air. Reduces moisture of the air. So the heater reduces the moisture of the air. So when I'm saying that the heater reduces moisture of the air just means that the air will become drier, or the air will become dehydrated, more like the water vapor in the air will be less. The air will be less humid, for those who are doing geography. That is why always whenever you turn on a heater, you need to put a cup of water at the side, just to make sure that the air does not go dry. So if there is a heater, it will reduce the moisture of the air, and the person that is sleeping in that room will inhale this dry air. So when a person inhales this dry air, gaseous exchange cannot take place easily, or something like that. Yeah, gaseous exchange cannot take place. So what do I mean by this? So actually, for gaseous exchange to take place, remember that this area need to be humid. There must be some vapor. Yeah, it needs to be humid. The air that is coming in there from the atmosphere will actually have some amount of moisture in it. So that's why gaseous exchange can take place easily. But when you dry the air will just do what? The air will not be able to provide enough oxygen to move into the blood. So when a person inhales that dry air, gaseous exchange cannot take place. And if, of course, gaseous exchange cannot take place, it means that oxygen will not be able to reach the cells, right, for cellular respiration. So oxygen will no longer be able to reach the cells. Oxygen will not be able to reach cells for cellular respiration. So that's a consequence. And when cellular respiration does not take place, you do not live, because we live through cellular respiration. Cellular respiration is the one that absorbs the oxygen, releases the carbon dioxide and energy. So here, if gaseous exchange does not take place, it means that the oxygen will not reach the blood. And when the oxygen does not reach the blood, it eventually means that cellular respiration and other metabolic processes that need to happen, they will no longer happen. So the failure of those processes to happen, it will eventually be fatal. It will lead to death at some point if that person continues to sleep in that room. Yes, so this is pretty much it of this exercise. I hope that each and everyone understands what is going on here. And thank you all for watching. Don't forget to tune in to our next video.